Emotions will be a little better.
I never saw the before picture. I just saw the after picture. Looked like,
well, I shouldn't
still look messed up. Like his face was just rearranged. Yeah. Which I get. I mean, his dad was like an MMA fighter. Like,
yeah. We did a story.
It's open on the top. He swings it around. It falls out of the bag.
For those of you who are new, welcome. I'm Angela Ann with WBNS 10TV.
And I'm Jeff Hogan. I'm
taller than me.
I'm Jeff Hogan, her sidekick, TV wife. She tells me where to go. I was just talking to somebody about this. She tells me to show up somewhere, and I just show up somewhere, and we do this. But this has been several years in a row, right?
Yeah, we have.
Good time.
Well trained. So we want to welcome everybody because tonight will be a very special night. There are some amazing stories, and you're going to be just inspired by some of the extraordinary individuals who have really gone above and beyond just their typical day-to-day. And what they do has had such a lasting impact on some of the victims. Many of them are here with us. So these models of justice have all sacrificed in their own way to set examples that are now being followed around not only Central Ohio, but the state and the entire country.
You're going to hear a great deal of their stories tonight. They're stories of dedication and innovation that have changed the way that victims are treated. Very important topics here tonight. They have strengthened folks and their pursuit of justice here. And tonight, here to say a few words, I want to welcome in Justice League of Ohio Chairman of the Board, Craig Henderson, is with us tonight for a few words. Craig.
Good evening. Now we transition from the professional public speakers to the amateur public speakers here. But as you mentioned, I'm Craig Henderson. I'm chairman of the board of the Justice League of Ohio. I'd like to welcome all of you, our honorees and guests that are here tonight. Our honorees personify the goals of the Justice League of Ohio, which is to help victims of violent crime. Our new advocate is Chelsea Ginther. Where are you, Chelsea? Chelsea has been with us about a week, trial by fire. She comes to us with a master's degree in psychology and has already filled in very nicely for us. Our staff attorney, Elizabeth Well. Elizabeth joined us in 2013 in her work with crime victims' legal rights enforcement. Has broken new ground both in Ohio and nationally. So thank you for your work. Also like to offer special thanks to Andrew Franks of Strategery LLC for all the hours that he donates to the organization all year long and for many, many years going back through the history of the organization. Also like to recognize one of our volunteers, Joanne Aubrey. Joanne's a retired domestic relations attorney. She donates time each week to the organization to help our clients. Joanne, where are you? Also like to thank Farmers Insurance. They are our longest term sponsors. They've supported us for years and years very generously. We work closely with Chris Stanton and Claudia Lozier, and Farmers was the 2014 recipient of the Community Partner Award for the Models of Justice. So if the Farmers contingent could stand up and be recognized. They're kind of right there. Our other sponsors for the evening are Rosati Windows, Humana, Precise, Forensic Healthcare Consulting, Henderson Insurance Agency, and the law firm of Doty and Obenauer. I'd like to recognize the judges who have joined us tonight. Current year honoree, the Honorable Judge Teresa Delick. Past honoree, the Honorable Judge Paul Herbert. And the Honorable Judge Carrie Gladen, who's been a longtime supporter of the Justice League and crime victims' rights movement. Also joining us tonight is Bill Hedrick with the Columbus City Attorney's Office. Bill received the Prosecutorial Model of Justice Award in 2014. Many of you know or have heard of, anyway, Kathy Harper Lee, who's our executive director. Her personal experience as a victim of violent crime led to the founding of the Justice League of Ohio. Justice League is one of the first organizations of its kind in the country. Over the past 13 years, we've helped over 850 individuals and families. Sadly, about 75% of our services are for children. For those of you just learning about the Justice League tonight, we aren't the fictional superheroes that come to mind from the name, but I think some of those we have helped might argue with you on that point. We do good things for victims of violent crime who have nowhere else to turn. I met Kathy about 4 years ago at a business meeting, heard her story that day, and volunteered to be on the board the same day. It's a very rewarding experience to be involved with the group. And we have openings on the board. I hope if you like what you hear tonight, you would talk to one of the board members and possibly join us and help us as we move forward. Marion Cruzy, who's on the board now, I met her at the event in 2013, and by the time she went home that evening, she was on our board. So at this point, I'd like to introduce our founder and executive director, Kathy Harper Lee.
Thanks, Greg. Well, now that we're done pimping for board members and volunteers, again, anybody who wishes to talk to us about that, that'd be great. I do definitely want to thank everyone for being here tonight, and I'm so happy that you joined us to honor incredible, remarkable individuals from all over the state of Ohio. The best thing about this job are the people that we meet and the people whose lives that we come in contact with, and we get to see the strength and the resiliency that so many people have. And it's a real pleasure to be able to honor those tonight. I also want to thank our Board of Trustees. I don't know if many of you here tonight have been involved in nonprofits or run nonprofits, but the one thing that you definitely do know, if you've ever been involved in a nonprofit, is that it's important to have a board that is active and strong and dedicated. And that's one thing that we do have here, is a very strong board. So I really want to thank our board members, David Highland, Cindy Seitz, Michael Rosati, Craig Henderson, Bill Johnson, Hannah Botkin-Doty, Ruth Johnson, and Marion Cruzy, who are all here tonight supporting the organization. They all volunteer their time to make this organization a much stronger, better organization, and I value each and every one of you. I am trying to stay on. And if you've ever heard me speak before, you know I ramble if I don't have a script, so I'm just trying to stick to the script. But anyway, what I wanted to say is 12 years ago, the Justice League of Ohio was one of the first organizations in the nation to provide free legal assistance to protect and enforce crime victims' rights throughout their criminal justice process. And at that time, when we're doing that work, everyone wondered what in the heck we were doing. Now 14 states have crime victims' rights legal clinics, and soon every state in the nation will have victims' rights legal clinics. Tonight you're going to hear a lot of different stories, but you're going to hear another story about the need for legal clinics and crime victims having their own representation to protect their rights. But before we begin, I want to share a couple things about the organization, because I know many of you are in the advocacy field or the criminal justice field, so I want to share a little bit of exciting news and a little bit of changes that are coming. First, the organization is getting ready to launch the Crime Victims Rights Toolkit. This was sort of came about a couple years ago when I was extremely frustrated that we have a very small staff. We have one staff attorney, myself. You know, sometimes we have volunteers, sometimes we don't. We have to turn people away constantly that desperately need help. So out of that frustration and the depression that came out of it, I thought, well, why don't we create a victims' rights toolkit that's similar to LegalZoom? And that's what we've done. And Andrew Franks has been an integral part of developing that organization, as well as Elizabeth Ball, our staff attorney. And we've created now a victims' rights toolkit where victims are going to be able to go online and look and determine what their rights are at every stage of the process, whether they've just hit the hospital or it's during investigation, prosecution, post-release control, and they'll be able to easily see and understand their rights in a chronological order. They'll be able to, we have letters that our attorneys have drafted that they can use those letters to send in to help exercise their rights, and we think this is going to go a long way in serving hundreds and hundreds of victims a year. So that's going to be, we're doing a presentation to the AG's office at 2 days in May, and shortly after that we'll be officially launching throughout the state. So anybody here want to help us beta test that? I'm sure we might need a little bit of time to work out a couple kinks, but we'll be starting our beta testing soon. And secondly, to better reflect the services we provide, we are going through some rebranding. We're going to be changing our name soon from the Justice League of Ohio, which doesn't really describe necessarily what we do, to the Ohio Crime Victim Justice Center. And we were so lucky to get the support and assistance of Cement Marketing, who has donated hours to helping us go through the rebranding process, creating the logos. That's not going to happen until, I'd say, about 6 months from now, but just wanted to let those that we're working with know that that's the change that's about to come. And really, that's it. So that's all I have to say tonight, other than I am so excited to get started with the program. I am so excited to share the stories of the remarkable honorees here this evening. Thank you.
Kathy, thank you, and we're excited because I think we just got a couple news stories. What do you think?
I think it just
fell in our lap. Exclusive on 10 TV.
Is that okay for 11 tonight?
11 p.m.?
We can make that announcement tonight at 11?
What's really funny is that Kathy's daughter is sitting with us, and she said, you guys know she X'd out a lot of her speech, didn't you? I know you.
It is certainly remarkable after being involved with this for just a few years to see the evolution of victims' crimes rights, the movement, and the exciting changes for the Justice League, and the new name fits right in with all that.
Well, shortly you will meet many of the honorees tonight, but before we begin, we do have a wonderful dinner here from the Villa Milano staff, and we're going to release you table by table to visit the buffet. I think the bar is still open, so that's always a good thing. But please enjoy your evening, meet new friends, talk amongst yourselves, and then we'll come back with our program in just a few minutes. So thank you.
As they say in Villa Milano, mangia.
Good evening again, friends. Hope you're enjoying your dinner tonight. We're going to go ahead and get started with our program. We apologize. We were just a little bit behind schedule, but that's okay. This gives us more time to say hello to everyone. Please feel free to continue enjoying your meal tonight. And if you'd like to follow along, there are programs at your table. But we do have just a few words to say about our honorees. So tonight, our first honoree is Laura Kaiser. Laura is a nurse for Mount Carmel Health System. She says she always knew she had a calling to be a nurse, and she felt that she could best serve victims of crime as a sexual assault nurse examiner, or SANE nurse, as most of you know it to be called. In 2013, Laura became a forensic nurse manager and realized that there was a problem in the system. She had to provide 24-hour one-on-one care to sexual assault victims in five hospitals with only seven nurses. Laura met that challenge by coming up with an innovative clinical program, which is the only one of its kind in the country. Mount Carmel Hospital's SANE curriculum allows nurses to complete their training in just 2 weeks' time. The nurses are trained at a higher level with a specialized lab using mannequins and real people. And because of this program that Laura created, Mount Carmel today employs 31 SANE trained nurses throughout all of Central Ohio. She says she's proud of this program because it will better help all sexual assault patients and ultimately every Ohio community. Common phrases her nurses hear Laura say include, "I'm always here for you," "Call me anytime," and I mean anytime, and "It is the best job in the world." Laura's nominator tonight, Ruth Downing, cannot join us, but please welcome two of Laura's SANE nurses who are with her tonight, Leanne Barber and Angeline Griffin, and our first honoree, Laura Kaiser. And if I could ask Kathy, along with Craig, to please come up here to the stage to present the award.
Having us this evening. It's been a pleasure to be here. They say recognition is the greatest motivator, but what it is it gets you recognized in the first place. The answer is you, Laura.
Laura, it's your dedication, loyalty, passion, and willingness to help others that gets you recognized this evening. You're a constant reminder of what it means to go above and beyond for the underserved. It's our honor and privilege to be mentored by an award-winning humanitarian such as yourself. Congratulations to our boss and friend, Laura Kaiser.
Thank you. I also want to thank, everybody's thanking me, but you know, it's our forensic nurse team that really makes a difference. Their dedication, their time, they work not only with Mount Carmel Health System, but they also take on the same program as a second position. So not only is all the time that they spend on their regular units, but they dedicate extra time out of their, you know, out of their day, out of their week. And sometimes if we have two cases at once, we have nurses that will step up and come in and say, you know, this is only a couple hours of my time to make a difference in someone that's been through some horrific event. And what a difference we can make. With the program we've created, it's really come a long, long way. And it's people like Ruth Downing. She is an awesome mentor for myself. It's our simulation center. It's our managers. It's our forensic nurse team that comes together to really make a difference for the community that we're serving. I am just really, really honored to receive this today. And I accept this for our entire team. Thank you.
This is our Advocate Model of Justice Award going to Leslie Ashworth. A long list of firsts follows Leslie Ashworth's name. She was just one step ahead of the legal community, teaching and preaching victims' rights to prosecutors and law enforcement officials before legislatures had officially passed the Ohio's Victims' Rights Law. She was also one of the first advocates to train Franklin County law enforcement about preferred arrest in a domestic dispute, and the importance of that determination when considering incarceration of either individual in that case. Leslie was one of the first in Franklin County to teach law enforcement, prosecutors, probation officers, judges, animal control officers, code officers, anybody who would listen to her, okay, and many others out there about the link between animal abuse and domestic violence and interpersonal violence. The Ohio Peace Officer Training Academy utilizes the curriculum developed by Leslie on domestic violence training for law enforcement, as well as the issue of interpersonal violence and the link with animal abuse. Leslie's work for crime victims is best stated by Honorable Judge Carrie Gladen, who said, and I quote, "By educating us and changing our views and behaviors, Leslie has helped us keep the crime victim in mind when going about our jobs in the justice system. She motivates us to want to do better and do what is right for crime victims. Most impactful is her work in educating others about the link between animal abuse and interpersonal violence." Judge Gladen and Ashley, come on up here and join us here, and please be recognized for this award tonight.
I first had my significant contact with Leslie about 25 years ago. I was a new prosecutor, and I did not keep the victim in mind. And I was not even to my office, and Leslie confronted me in the hallway. And she got my attention, and she explained to me the danger that I put this woman in by not considering what her rights were and consulting with her and consulting with the advocates before I did what I did. And I have never forgotten that day, Leslie. She's also then, from that day, been a mentor to me and just one of my very, very dear friends, and I look up to her so much, and thank you for all that you do. Love you.
I kind of feel like Susan Lucci. I've been doing this so long. And it's just, it's amazing. I'm so proud of the work that Kathy is doing. And I'm so proud of all the different components of advocacy that have come together throughout the years. As you heard, what I do now is basically dealing with the link between human violence and violence toward animals. And that is a whole new era and a whole new genre of dealing with crime and crime victims. I cannot thank you, Carrie, enough. If there were more judges like you, more judges that were willing to listen and pay attention, we wouldn't need the Justice League. But I'm so thankful it's here, and I'm so thankful, Kathy, for everything that you're doing. Thank you very much.
Now to our law enforcement model of justice, Patrolman Olin Mills from Sabina's Police Department. Here's what people in Sabina have to say about Patrolman Mills. This comes from Abby Howell. Patrolman Mills is not just a police officer that comes in and does his job and goes home. He really cares about the town and all who are in it. Even if he is not on duty, you can call him or go to his home and he will help you. He goes above and beyond every minute of every day. Ask anyone in Sabina, there is no shortage of extraordinary stories about Patrolman Mills and his dedication. Community member Trevor Talbot sent us this following story. Officer Mills was at his daughter's high school graduation off duty. A man had a medical emergency, and Officer Mills did exactly what he was trained to do, and without thinking twice, he took care of that man until the ambulance arrived. These are just some of the accolades that speak volumes about Patrolman Mills' character, his experience, and his commitment to his job and his fellow citizens. He is a trusted, experienced, and truly extraordinary law enforcement professional who not only connects with adults, but children alike on a level that leaves them unable to forget his positive impact that he's had on their lives. Please welcome Patrolman Mills and one of his nominators, Abby Howell. Come on up.
Should I say a few words first? I met Officer Mills about 4 or 5 years ago when he first started. There was a court order preventing me from helping my daughter. I had to send her to visitations. He was so dedicated to his job that he came in 2 days after heart surgery, less than 10 minutes after he'd gotten home from the hospital, just because he knew the call was for her. He makes random stops at your house just to see. I've seen him help everybody. My daughter had me chase him down at Christmas just to give him a box of cookies. We drove all over Sabina just to get him to stop, and he did. And if you ask her, and she's almost 7, who her best friend is, and she'll tell you that it's Officer Mills.
You know, I wanted to come prepared tonight, but with the weather being warm and everything, the crime is starting to pick up, so here I am winging it. I'm honored to get this award. To me, I go out and do my job, and that's the only thing that I do. I don't go above and beyond. Kids are everything to me. I mean, if I can help out a child, they're a product of their environment. They act the way they're raised. So if I can change one thing in a child, that's what I do. Thank you.
Thank you, Officer, for making the trip from Clinton County here tonight. Our Judicial Model of Justice Award to the Honorable Judge Teresa Delick of Mahoning County. Listen to this quote, first off, from someone in Mahoning County's juvenile court. Often the juvenile justice system is only concerned with the offender and his or her rehabilitation. The court has made victim rights a priority by instituting a victim impact program, mediation, and restitution fund. Each judicial decision is designed to encompass the victim's rights as well as and not to overlook any damage that has resulted to the victims. That quote is from Linda McNally, and it summarizes Judge Delick's uncommon and highly commendable dedication to protecting the rights of crime victims. Her courtroom provides a restitution program where the offender performs court-supervised community service and receives payment for the work. But instead of the offender receiving the wages, that money is sent to the victim with payment of any bills and losses suffered because of the crime. Since its inception, this work restitution program has paid over $75,000 to its victims. Another program, the VIP, which requires offenders to actively participate, do homework, and complete a program designed to educate them on the impact of crime. It's a 7-week program, helps understand emotions, empathy, and the power of restitution. Aside from the great strides she's made in the courtroom, Judge Delick has also helped draft juvenile legislation for the state of Ohio. She's recruited to speak at law seminars all across the country, and she volunteers at nearly a dozen different organizations in the Youngstown area. We want to thank Linda McNally and Lisa Mastris for nominating Judge Delick for her dedication. Come on up.
Hi, everyone. My name is Anthony D'Apolito. I'm the Juvenile Court Administrator for Judge Delick. It's my sincere pleasure to introduce Judge Delick, and I'm not just saying that because she's my boss. She has been instrumental in transforming how our community and how many outside our community think about juvenile justice. She's taught me and those at our court to look for the root causes of juvenile delinquency, to identify them and to treat them. She's taught us to be proactive in preventing delinquency, to be quick to implement programming when addressing delinquency, and to be compassionate to and never forget the needs of victims as we exert every effort to make them whole. Ladies and gentlemen, the Judicial Model of Justice recipient for 2015, Mahoning County Juvenile Judge Teresa Delick.
I have two things to say. I'd hug him, but he's the only Italian I know who doesn't hug. Sorry, scooted away. And then secondly, who's that? When they asked for a picture, I said, I don't have anything with what I look like right now, so I'm sorry. Everyone's looking for somebody else. But thank you so much for having me here tonight and having this wonderful banquet for all the honorees. Thank you, Kathy, for starting it all with your story. It was very brave of you to come forward, which is very hard, but you don't like to hear it, I'm sure, but thank you, because look all that you've done across the state and across the country, so thank you. And to the board, I thank you too, because I know you're all volunteer, and that takes so much time. And you're thinking, geez, what are we really doing? But you're doing a lot, so thank you all for your time. And for the other honorees, geez, I had to come up after Officer. Oh my gosh, I said, of all people I had to follow, you're like a saint. So, but thank you. I got to meet most of the honorees, and it was a pleasure to be here. Again, we're at juvenile court, and we do everything we can to restore victims to the extent possible, and we know we can't do it. That's why we say to the extent possible, because sometimes it's impossible, but we do believe in balanced and restorative justice, and if they really work on that, we try to make sure they don't let that moment define them, because it's just a moment in time, and we can't let that moment define them. They're more than that. But the award really goes to the staff, because I'm just the figurehead who changes haircuts every now and then. And our staff, we have a table of people here from Mahoning County and from Columbus who've come, so thank you so much for joining us. Our staff deserves it because they do the hard work, and I love working with them. Thank you.
And now to our special courage model of justice. Danielle Moreland, she's a loving mother. Danielle Moreland is a hardworking employee, but mostly Danielle Moreland is a fighter. Since 2009, Danielle has been fighting a battle. That is when she left her husband at the time, and that is when he began his relentless attack, harassment, and abuse against Danielle and her three children. It wasn't until his conviction, did Daniel realize the extent of his violent history, severely assaulting three former girlfriends, threatening a police officer that he would shoot him, cut his head off, and feed it to his dogs, not to mention a host of other threats and violent crimes I choose not to say. In 2011, the county prosecutor stopped pursuing charges against Daniel's offender because a presiding municipal court judge refused to hear any domestic violence-related case while their divorce was pending. So the attacks against Danielle continued and got worse. Frustrated but determined, Danielle reached out to a battered women's shelter for help. At Turning Point in Marion, Danielle found the Justice League. With the help of the Justice League and an article in the Columbus Dispatch, that municipal judge recused himself from the case. Yet prosecutors still would not pursue the charges against the offender. Did I mention Danielle's a fighter? She didn't give up. In early 2015, again with the help from the Justice League, Danielle filed an affidavit in support of arrest or prosecution. Today, the Special Prosecutions Unit in the Ohio Attorney General's office is handling her case and hopefully will file 13 felony counts against her offender. Danielle, your courage to never give up the pursuit for justice is admirable. We know that there is a light at the end of the tunnel coming soon. I want to welcome Justice League Staff Attorney Elizabeth Well for this nomination, and please welcome Danielle Moreland to accept the Special Courage Award.
Absolutely. I've said it on the news numerous times now, I think, but Danielle is inspirational. She is the nicest, sweetest, most wonderful person you will ever meet, and also one of the strongest people I have ever met. So I think that pretty much sums it up, and I'll let her say a few words.
I am very honored to be here tonight, and I want to thank the Justice League and Kathy and Elizabeth for everything that you've helped me with. I don't think during this journey I would have been able to make it through much without the help of you. Though the journey's been pretty turbulent, I actually want to thank everybody here tonight because obviously you're here because you care about victims' rights. So I want to say thank you to all of you. So thank you.
Next, our corporate partner model of justice, Rosati Windows. Who has a Rosati window in your house? Everyone say hi. Oh, Mike, look at all these customers, right? I'm just kidding. Rosati Windows has consistently supported organizations and causes since their founding over a decade ago. The Justice League of Ohio has been fortunate enough to benefit from Michael Rosati's generosity and his leadership. He, along with Rosati Windows CFO Cindy Seitz, have become valued members of the board, as well as generous sponsors of the organization. Together, Michael and Cindy have elevated the Justice League with the same dedication, commitment, and quality, plus the follow-through that has made Rosati Windows one of the nation's leading home improvement companies. Rosati Windows has consistently won awards year after year for their excellent products and their service, but we are honored to bestow upon them one more. The 2015 Corporate Partner Model of Justice for the immense contributions that they have made, their dedications to crime victims' rights, and I have to say, I think he's on TV more than me and Jeff combined. But well deserved. Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Rosati and Cindy Seitz.
I just want to thank everybody for coming. You know, it's a cause that we believe in. We believe in Kathy, and we appreciate every one of you showing up tonight. Thank you.
I'm kind of unprepared, and I guess I have to tell the truth. Kathy may never send me another email, but I am completely I didn't know this was going on because I didn't read an email that she sent me. So I didn't prepare anything. You know, I met Kathy through Cindy, I don't know, how long has it been? 09? 8? I don't know how long it's been, 6-7 years. Immediately knew that she was someone that I wanted to be involved with. Been on the board ever since then. She fights the fight, and that's what I'm about. I'm about kids, and I'm about people taking care of kids, and she does some amazing things. And being on the board, we see the stuff that you guys don't see. You know, we see the struggles that she has, the tears that she has over some of the cases that she has to deal with, and some of the unbelievable stuff that goes on. And she continues to fight, and she continues to fight, and she scratches and scratches for money. And guys, if your checkbook's a little loose tonight, you gotta write her a check. Thanks.
Law enforcement model of justice now, Detective John Morgan, Cuyahoga County Sheriff's Office, FBI Violent Crimes Task Force. Here's a quote. Patients trust Detective Morgan and feel he truly is there to help them. He also knows that to help these patients, it truly is an interdisciplinary approach and that these patients need to have their rights upheld and for them to get better. That's how forensic nurse Deborah Casey described Cuyahoga County Sheriff's Detective John Morgan when she nominated him for this award. Detective Morgan is an accomplished and highly decorated expert in the fields of missing persons and human trafficking. He speaks about the topic from Cleveland to Portland, Oregon, and all points in between across the country. Detective Morgan has been given over 10 awards recognizing his outstanding service to his country, his community, and his career. As a member of the FBI's Violent Crimes Task Force, Detective Morgan is well respected among the ranks from the county to the state to the feds. His professional can-do attitude helps other professionals understand and identify the signs of human trafficking while also offering support to the victims they find. Deborah couldn't be here tonight, but do please welcome Detective John Morgan from Cuyahoga County.
Such kind words, and she isn't here, unfortunately. For me, dealing with human trafficking, it all started back in 2009. We at the Violent Crimes Task Force actually purchased a 16-year-old girl from a trafficker in downtown Cleveland. After that happened, a passion grew in me that this had to be stopped. Just like everyone in this room has passion for what they do and that the victim's rights, the passion grew in me to stop and to educate people to stop the trafficking. Here recently in Cuyahoga County, about 2 years ago, we were involved with 16 pimps that had been put behind bars, just dealing with underage victims, not even talking the adult victims, just underage victims. And just last year alone, in 1 week in our region, we recovered 16 victims, 16 and under, involved in domestic sex trafficking. That's just in 1 week. Our goal the first few years with the FBI was to educate law enforcement to stop that old train of thought that, oh, she's just a prostitute on the street, there's no reason, or who cares while she's out here, and to start getting our local law enforcement officers to actually stop and think, she's not out here because she wants to be out here. Let's look a little bit deeper and let's see what we can find. And now what we've started doing in the great state of Cuyahoga, we like to call it, is we've started now trying to mend the problems that we have with our other partners, like the Department of Children and Family Services, where these children just kind of fall through the cracks and become victims of domestic sex trafficking. There, we've started a human trafficking program with our Department of Children and Family Services, trying to get the social workers trained to help identify our potential victims of sex trafficking. I'd like to thank, you know, this lovely organization. I would like to be, you know, your conduit up there in Cuyahoga. Because unfortunately, everyone knows that there's gonna be a little disconnect between Franklin and Cuyahoga County. We're so far away. But there's a lot of people, there's a lot of victims up there that could utilize this agency a great deal. I'd like to thank my wife for putting up with all of the phone calls at 12:30 saying you gotta come out and talk to people. And again, the partnerships that we've made through this to include our SANE nurses, who are vital and important. Very, very important. They're our first line, and if you can make contact with them, they will drop a line to you and say, you know what, there's a gut, my gut's telling me something's wrong here, and that's why you call us and we come out. So thank you. Thank you again.
Picture? Come on. Kathy, I think he just got a new board member. He's right there. He's like, okay. Now to our attorney model of justice from Franklin County's Public Defender's Office, Jody Thomas. Let me tell you about Jody, who's got a fan club with her tonight. During her 13 years with the Franklin County Public Defender's Office, Jody has built a strong reputation for providing solutions to her clients that not only help them legally, but also set them on a path to change their lives for the better. Coming from both a legal and a social work background, Jody is able to make thoughtful and effective decisions regarding her clients' short and long-term best interests. She worked in both the juvenile and municipal divisions of the Public Defender's Office before being selected as the group leader for the specialized dockets in 2013. These specialized dockets include the Mental Health Court, Military and Veterans Court, Alcohol and Drug Addiction Program, the Opiate Extension Program, and Changing Actions to Change Habits Specialized Docket, better known as Catch Court. Now, the Catch Court program was developed to address the needs of defendants who were charged with prostitution, solicitation, and/or other crimes when there's a history of human trafficking. Many of those victims also suffer from alcohol or drug dependency and/or mental illness. Well, today, Jody is being honored for her important work in defending those victims who often turn to that lifestyle as a product of their trauma. She guides them through this intensive program, follows their amazing journeys, and watches them achieve a better life for themselves. Melissa Furman nominated Jody for the 2015 Attorney Models of Justice Award. Melissa is with us tonight, as well as Jody. Please welcome both.
Good evening. I wasn't sure, to be honest, when I drafted this nomination for Jody. I'm like, I'm nominating a public defender for an award in a crime victims' rights organization. I'm not quite sure how that's going to go over. And myself being pretty prosecution and victim-oriented, I had some doubts. But what you need to understand about Jody is this isn't just any public defender. I had the opportunity to interact with Jody when I was a prosecutor myself. I have friends in the Catch Court program and have talked to quite a few of her colleagues about her professionalism. But more so than that, this is not just a job anyone could do. It takes someone with Jody's extraordinary compassion, enthusiasm for her job, and her social work background makes her very uniquely qualified to represent these women in Catch Court. And having talked with her colleagues and having observed her myself, I was very impressed, and I can tell you, having worked in public service and still working in public service, when you interact with the public every day, you interact with victims, defendants alike, it's very easy to become jaded. It's very easy to become burned out. And I never saw that in Jody. I saw somebody who came in every day with the same level of enthusiasm and the same passion and compassion day in and day out. And that is so hard to do. I can't even tell you. So it is my great pleasure to see Jody recognized for her work.
Good evening. I do this every day. I talk in court, but this is a little more difficult for me to be up here. I'm just absolutely honored and blessed and grateful to be selected for this award. Never dreamed that I would be recognized for the work that I do for the Public Defender's Office. I absolutely love my job. I love that I get to come into work every day and work with amazing judges, especially Judge Herbert, who presides over our CATCH program. I get to work with prosecutors, probation officers, court staff, case managers, community advocates, and we all work together as a team to figure out a way to help these victims that are labeled as defendants and help them get through the legal system and come up with a plan to make their lives better and give them what they deserve. I spent the afternoon, every Thursday is CATCH court, and it is absolutely my favorite day of the week. I get to go in and see these wonderful ladies that I represent, that I get to see them literally before my eyes changing into absolutely beautiful women, and they are living the life that they deserve. And so I'm just absolutely honored that I get to be here. A couple weeks ago, I did run into one of my clients who is getting ready to graduate the CATCH program. And I told her how excited I was that I was gonna get to be at her graduation. And she says, well, it was because of you that I'm here. And I said, no, you did all the work. You went through the treatment and coming to court every week and doing all the things that were asked of you. And she said, well, you were the one who gave me a different option. I didn't just plea her out and move on to the next case. She said that I gave her that opportunity for change and to give her something different that she didn't have before. And thinking of that and receiving the sword, it's just absolutely an honor. So thank you very much. Thank you for my bosses here from the Franklin County Public Defender's Office. And just so glad that he gave me the opportunity to be in the position that I am, to be part of the specialized dockets. So thank you very much. Very honored.
Can I be included in Jody's cheering section there? It's a great group that you guys have, and our families are actually great friends as well. And before I saw the script this week heading into this, I had no idea that she was being honored. So congratulations, Jody. That's fantastic. Right now, a special Courage Model of Justice Award to Vanessa Perkins. And we're speaking, there we go, because we're speaking of CATCH court. And here we go, round two. Vanessa Perkins is considered one of the top success stories from there. At a young age, Vanessa moved to Columbus and met someone she thought would provide the love and protection that she had sought throughout her abusive life. Instead, though, she was forced to engage in commercial sex acts as a trafficking victim. It was a nightmare that lasted 5 years. In 2009, Vanessa found herself in CATCH court, and after 2 years, her life began to change. In 2013, Vanessa graduated from Judge Paul Herbert's CATCH court, and soon she became a role model for other women. She exemplified Judge Herbert's premise that given a chance and through hard work, women who have been caught in a downward spiral of victimization can change the direction of their lives. Vanessa was soon offered a part-time job with the prosecutor's office intake unit, where she helped victims of crime with filing criminal charges. How ironic, she'd say to herself at that point. She now worked for the same court system that once tried to convict her. Part-time led to full-time, now to a legal administrative assistant for the domestic violence unit, where she works with 4 specialized prosecutors. Vanessa, you are certainly an inspiration to everyone in this room here tonight, your coworkers who nominated you. I want you to welcome up here, along with Judge Herbert and Columbus Assistant City Prosecutor Bill Hedrick. Vanessa, please come up.
Fighting over the mic.
And believe it or not, we're fighting on which one will speak and which one won't.
All right. Good evening. Just to give you perspective on what an amazing journey. It's, you know, we've got the police here that rescue them, we've got the attorneys here that refer them, then we've got the judge here that sees what happens. And just to give you a perspective on what it is that comes before our court as a human trafficking victim. It's not just a word that you hear in a Hollywood movie. It is someone who's dealing with almost every problem that we have, a victim of domestic violence, a victim of rape and child sexual abuse, homelessness, mental health issues, drug addictions, women's health needs, joblessness. You have every social service that's on you. So when they come to the court, they are about the last straw. And so I really am glad that I've just been at the right place in the right time to see this thing grow and to see wonderful superstars like that. They have a saying out there on the street, make her believe in heaven and she will follow you to hell. That's the theory of the traffickers, and that's what happened to Vanessa. So when she came to us, she didn't trust anybody. She didn't want anybody's help. That's when she finally turned the keys over and let my staff help her. And then once she got done with the catch court, I'll let Bill tell you how the rest turned out, and then we'll hear from Vanessa.
Again, my name's Bill Hedrick. I'm the Chief of Staff of the Columbus City Attorney's Office. So that means among the many things I do, I'm in charge of HR, hiring. And the prosecutor's office has always been supportive of the catch court. And every week, Judge Herbert keeps an open court, and many people go and they watch and they hear the success stories of the catch court. And my question was, and I'm always a skeptic on things, so I was seeing a lot of people succeeding in this program, but what I wasn't hearing a lot about is where were they getting jobs? Because it is wonderful that the women can make it through this program, but they need that extra step to get them to the next point in life. And they're doing heroic things. They have the food vending service they're doing. Chipotle is giving them jobs. There's nothing wrong with those types of jobs. But I'm like, what other kinds of jobs can we offer these individuals to help them have success? So I approached City Attorney Pfeiffer, who is my boss, and I said, would you be open to us possibly hiring someone from the catch court? Particularly, my ultimate goal is maybe we can shame other employers to stepping up to the plate. Because if the prosecutor's office can be brave enough to hire someone from catch court, why can't you? So I approached Judge Herbert and I said, and we had to be very careful about this, we need a specific type of individual. I want an individual who's going to succeed. And they're going to have a lot of pressure on them because the light's going to be upon them. And my fear was if we get someone and they don't succeed, then it's going to be harder in the future to do this again. So originally what we started in, I was suggested that there was this wonderful person in the program, Vanessa Perkins. So I met Vanessa, I sort of put her through the paces and told her what she should expect. And I also made it clear to her, we would give her an opportunity. We weren't going to give her a gift, we're going to give her an opportunity. So I approached Mr. Tobias, who's sitting in the back at table 8, who's the director of our intake unit, and he handles part-time jobs. So we gave her a part-time job in the intake unit, and this was our testing point. Vanessa has exceeded beyond all our expectations. She's now one of our full-time employees, and we have promoted her within the office twice. I can't tell you how proud I am of Vanessa Perkins. So I'll just leave it with, Vanessa has given our office so much more than what we've given to her. So I present to you Vanessa Perkins.
That was really good. So my heart is like beating out of my chest. And thank you guys for those amazing words. I didn't know all that they were saying. So it's really awesome to hear that. And yes, I was really scared because I didn't feel deserving of having a position at the city attorney's office. And my upbringing said, that is not okay. The cops are the bad guys. That's how I was raised. But anyway, to have this opportunity has been unbelievable to
to be around victim-centered mindsets is a whole different ballgame for me, because where I come from, if you're a victim, you're weak, you're no good, it's your fault. Like, that's what I was raised with. So to be around people like you with the mindset, I'm on a domestic violence unit with tons of advocates and prosecutors who are fighting for victims. Like, it is amazing. I am so lucky to be where I'm at, and I'm so thankful for people like you that have this mindset. I didn't understand it. I was the defendant. I was the one coming in handcuffs, and the people I work for actually has convicted me and now employ me, which is just doesn't make sense to me. I didn't think I was any good for that, you know? I don't deserve something like that, and that's what I believed. And this human trafficking thing is starting to, man, I appreciate you guys so much. I can't even explain it, but like has really blown up. It's always been there, but like I think the education has really blown up to where like I didn't know predators knew what they were doing. I just thought it was all my fault. I did it. It's my fault. I'm an idiot. It's, you know, so I'm just to be where I'm at today. And now I get phone calls on a regular basis saying, hey, can you come down and talk to this lady? I get the honor of walking down and talking to a lady locked to the very same wall I used to be locked to. And I get to look at her in her eyes and see her just broken self, and it just is unbelievable. And hopefully just shed a little bit of hope that you don't have to live like this, and that there's hope, there's a solution for this stuff. So anyway, I don't know where I'm going with this, but just thank you guys. The food was amazing. You guys are amazing. Thanks for doing what you do.
I gotta tell you, I've heard Vanessa speak before. I could listen to her for hours. I mean, she is just real. And I gotta give a shout out to two other friends of hers that are at the table about to graduate from Catch Court. Stand up, ladies, come on, be recognized. Future success stories there. It's what we're all about tonight. So our final honorees, it's actually kind of a group award, if you will. And let me tell you their story. About these individuals. It has been said that it takes a village to raise a child. Undoubtedly, it takes a village to do a lot of things. But these next models of justice prove that sometimes it takes a village to achieve justice for a victim of crime. Latrice Miller was the victim of a brutal rape back in 2009. Through her trauma, she found hope from complete strangers, like Detective Sergeant David Lomax, who showed compassion during the interview process while making Latrice feel safe and protected. There was also Lynn Bylow, a victim's advocate who was always there to answer Latrice's questions about the sometimes confusing criminal justice process. Then there's Justice League staff attorney Elizabeth Well, who took on Latrice's rape case after learning that she had endured 20 continuances in her accuser's trial that lasted over 5 years. Imagine the harm, the emotional and financial harm that would do to anyone. This little village would not be complete, though, without attorney Conrad Kircher, who, along with Elizabeth, filed an unprecedented action in the 7th District Appellate Court, asking the appeals court to compel the trial court judge to hear Latrice's objections and finally bring that defendant to trial. Well, on April 6th, 2015, shortly after that filing of the action in the appellate court, the trial court listened, and a jury convicted the defendant of rape. So now we want to tell you a little bit about each of those individuals. And as we read your bio, please just come up here, because you deserve to be just highlighted under these beautiful lights as we talk a little bit more about you. Jeff?
We start with law enforcement model of justice, Detective Sergeant David Lomax from the Youngstown Police Department.
Where are
you? He couldn't make it tonight, but there he is. Can I read the nice words about him?
Yes.
Effective investigator, compassionate supporter, community organizer, hero. Those are just a few of the words that a lot of people have used to describe Detective Sergeant David Lomax of the Youngstown Police Department. Detective Sergeant Lomax specializes in domestic violence and sexual assaults. He understands better than most how fragile these victims can be and how crucially important it is to treat them with fairness, dignity, respect, and compassion. So when he met Latrice Miller in 2009, his caring and compassion was embraced by the young victim. His skills as an investigator and interrogations would later play a huge role in the conviction of Latrice's offender. But what is key to this story is that as Latrice began to lose hope through all those trial continuances, Detective Sergeant Lomax stuck by her side, never losing sight of her case and letting her know throughout it all that she wasn't alone. Detective Lomax is a true hero, not just to Latrice, but to so many victims of sexual assault and domestic violence taking place in the city of Youngstown. So we thank him for that. We wish he could be here.
Lynn Bilo. Lynn, can you come on up? There you are. Come on up. I want people to see you. Lynn is an advocate for victims and so much more. She has over 20 years of experience as a crisis intervention specialist who assists crime victims. She's a strong presence in her community as a member of the Ohio Domestic Violence Network, the Ohio Alliance to End Sexual Violence, and she's an advisory board member, volunteer, and fundraiser for the YWCA. Currently, as a program manager for Compass Rape Crisis and Counseling Center, Lynn is also a recruiting and training volunteer. She's recruiting volunteers for the Mahoning Valley Organizing Collaborative. For Latrice, though, Lynn was an advisor, that supporter, that shoulder to cry on, an advocate, and much more. Lynn, we want to thank you for truly being an outstanding advocate and a community leader.
When I got the call about this award, I thought, am I really getting an award for doing my job? And I feel very honored to get it, but I feel like when you're given an opportunity such as this to serve victims or survivors, you just do what you're supposed to do. You do the right thing. So when I ran into Kathy at one of the 2 days of May events and I was talking with her about what her program offers, I was like, I have the perfect case. Like, this case is ridiculous and she needs more help than what I can give her as an advocate. So because Latrice allowed me into her life and to accept a referral to the Justice League, that's why we're here today. So I really want to thank Latrice because she reported her assault and she allowed me to assist her through that process. Thank you.
So Lynn, like you said, Latrice, can you come up? Is Latrice here?
Yep.
She can come up, please come up, yeah. Like Lynn was saying, Latrice did what she was supposed to do, but the justice system did not. In September of 2009, Latrice was brutally raped by a coworker. As the daughter of a police officer, Latrice did what she was supposed to do as a victim, and she got herself to the hospital, she got treatment, she got evidence collected, and reported that crime to police. The strength to do that after an attack like that can never be overstated. In 2010, her attacker, Maurice Clark, was indicted for kidnapping and 2 counts of rape. Everything seemed to be on track, but the case soon derailed. Soon it became clear that something wasn't right, and over the next 5 years, the trial court inexplicably allowed over 20 continuances to this case. Latrice would prepare herself for trial each time, mentally, emotionally, taking time off of work, arranging for childcare, only to learn at the last minute that the trial had been postponed again. The delays took a tremendous toll, but thanks to her advocate, Lynn, she found help with the Justice League. And as you heard before, thanks to the appeals court forcing the judge to set a trial date, Latrice's offender was convicted, and next month, he'll be sentenced. Latrice, your strength to endure not only that attack, but the years of agonizing court delays truly shows the pursuit for justice and what it really means. Because of you, a violent offender has been removed from the community, and you are a courageous model of justice for us all and a great example. Thank you.
not used to speaking in front of a lot of people, but it's been a long road for me since 2009. And Ms. Lynn been by my side from day one. And when she told me about the Justice League, I was kind of, oh, I don't want to go through that. I don't believe in any, nobody was helping me. I wasn't getting any justice. But once I spoke to Ms. Kathy, everything changed because she's a fighter like I am. And she didn't give up on me. And I just want to say thank you and I love you.
Lives are changed. All right, Latrice, stay right there because we have two more people that we want to come up and join you. I'm going to ask attorneys Conrad Kircher and Elizabeth Well to please come up here as well, if you don't mind. Come on. So let me tell you first about Conrad. He's stepping up first. He is a former Marine, holds a bachelor's degree in political science, a master's degree in international affairs, and a Juris Doctorate. He has over 20 years' experience as an attorney in the state of Ohio, taking cases all the way to the Ohio Supreme Court. As an attorney, Conrad is an unyielding advocate for crime victims. There are very few civil attorneys that would willingly take up a cause such as justice for crime victims, but he does it, and it is especially refreshing to see a talented and experienced attorney like Conrad just racing up to that mantle. Conrad often donates his time to the Justice League. Did I say donate? Donate his time to the Justice League, all in the pursuit of protecting crime victims' rights. His knowledge of the appellate court process was extremely valuable in Latrice's case, and we want to thank you, Conrad, for your dedication to that case. Let me tell you about attorney Elizabeth Well. You heard from her a little bit earlier tonight. But she received her Juris Doctorate from Ohio Northern University, graduated at the top of her class. She is an exceptional attorney that any major law firm would be grateful to have, yet she chose to join the Justice League of Ohio to protect and enforce crime victims' rights. Representing crime victims in criminal court is not a glamorous job, certainly not easy either. But since enforcing crime victims' rights is still rather a new concept, Elizabeth is often met with opposition. Just a little? Okay. As a result, there are many firsts, one of which was filing the writ of mandamus in Latrice's case. I'm not a lawyer. Please tell me I said that right. Good. Anyways, Elizabeth says she has chosen this profession because of her dedication and passion to ensuring that crime victims are heard and that their rights are protected. So, Conrad and Elizabeth, please share a few words, if you will.
Thank you. The program indicates that I'm being honored as the pro bono attorney of the year, and I'm familiar with that term. I think it has two translations. It's a Latin term. One translation means bad business plan, and the second one means sucker. But you know what? Pro bono work has rewards that money can't buy. Latrice is a great example. As a trial lawyer, I'm a storyteller. Let me tell one. About 6 years ago, mother and father brought their 16-year-old girl to my office. The parents were infuriated. They just found out that their 16-year-old daughter had been molested repeatedly by an elderly neighbor from the ages of 8 to 12, and this was a trusted family friend. Her name was Brittany, the 16-year-old, and she hadn't told anybody until just recently. She told a high school classmate. High school classmate told counselor. Counselor is a mandated reporter, told law enforcement. Law enforcement set up a pretextual call between Brittany and the perpetrator. He confessed. He ran to get a skilled defense attorney, copped a real favorable plea of 2 years, and at the time that the dust settled and the family came to me, he was serving a 2-year sentence for taking this little girl's innocence. So the family said, where's the justice? You know, that can't be all there is. And I talked to him about a civil case, but all you can do is sue for money, but it has other positive impacts. And I knew that Brittany, who was a very introverted girl who barely spoke, never had a boyfriend, lived in kind of a shell, I knew that she didn't realize it at that point, but at some point she was going to need validation and that this would be part of her healing. So the parents said, we want to sue him. We sued him, and I didn't think that Brittany would ever be able to testify, and I didn't think we'd ever want to put her through that. But let's file the suit. Let's give Brittany some control, some some ability to regain her dignity. And the case went on. A year and a half later, we were set for trial. 3 weeks before trial, Brittany was now 18 years old. The case was hers. She could make her own decisions. And I had seen her grow a little bit throughout the case. She was in counseling. But the family had said, okay, we can come up with $10,000 to settle the case. We can come up with $15,000. And it was a Chinese water torture. But finally, they came up with $35,000. They said, that's the most we can come up with. 3 weeks before trial. So I bring in Brittany and her parents. And I say, Brittany, it's the best we can do. It's nowhere near what you deserve, but you can use it for school. You can use it for additional counseling. Your other option is to go before a jury and testify. And I waited out and I said, so is that what you want to do? And she sat up in her chair. She said, I want to tell my story. I still get goosebumps today thinking about that. And my eyes, I think, probably got watery. And I said, good for you, Brittany. Let's go tell your story. We went to a jury trial, and it was the most delicate direct examination I've ever done in my life because Brittany wanted to tell her story, but she could only do it a few words at a time. So I'd ask her a question. She'd give a sentence of 4 or 5 words. I'd have to ask the next question. The jury was enthralled. They loved her. The jury was out for 45 minutes, came back with a $3.6 million verdict, totally uncollectible. The guy was in prison, had no assets, had no income. The wife was divorcing him. It wasn't about the money. But what a statement. So Brittany was all kind of puzzled by it all. She just kind of sat there as the verdict was read and the judge was talking to the jury, thanked for the service, and then dismissed them. When the jury left, I turned to Brittany and I said, did you hear what the jury told you? And she kind of looked at me puzzled, and I said, they told you it wasn't your fault. And she had a smile on her face at that point. She stood up, and I'm pleased to report that Brittany's doing very well. She's in college classes. She's had counseling throughout. She's living a life, and she's healing. The reason I tell that story, everyone in this room is here for the Brittanys and the Latrices, and we need each other because it's a lonely world out there. And we draw strength from each other. Let's keep up the good fight. Let's keep making an impact. Thank you.
As per usual, Conrad is an impossible act to follow. So I just want to thank Kathy, because I know she probably wrote those kind words about me. And I want to thank the Justice League and the board and everyone for giving me a chance because I'm pretty young, but I'm not as young as I hope I look. And I want to thank all of you as well. And I especially want to thank Danielle and Latrice for being here tonight. I know them personally. I've worked with them. They're both wonderful. And I'm so glad that we're, got a good outcome for Latrice and hopefully going to get one for Danielle as well.
I will tell you that the one thing that I find that runs in common with the folks here tonight is that they're all fighters and they're all leaders in their own right and they're all courageous in their own ways, and they are great examples of what is just in the end, and that's something inspiring to see out of all of you. I do want to make mention there's a group here tonight that was mentioned at the beginning. I want to mention them one more time at the end because it has a lot to do with the name change. Cement Marketing LLC. Kathy mentioned them at the top, but they've been responsible for the change over here. They donated their time and their talent and their resources for the Ohio Crime Victim Justice Center moving forward. So the rebranding process, we appreciate what they have done for that.
Can we have our friends from Cement Marketing come on up, please, and accept this surprise award, not in the program. Breaking news.
I just really quickly wanted to say, we wanted just to show our appreciation. As you know, we have no budget whatsoever. And so it means a lot that your company, that you would take this time personally to help us grow, to help us, to help position us in a place where we can do more to serve more people. So I just wanted to say thank you. Craig wanted to say, this wonderful award together for you. So anyway, thank you so much.
Kathy, get in there.
How many pictures have you taken tonight? Come on.
Oh, this is the last one. Come on, guys.
That's the last one. Step forward. How about another big round of applause for all of our honorees tonight, our models of justice, standing up for victims' rights. We look around this room. Yes, how about a standing ovation? Stretch those legs and tell these awardees that we just love them for what they've done. Thank you. Kudos, kudos, kudos. I love it. As we close out your evening tonight, real quick to those awardees, you may notice that your awards are missing the actual little scales. That is by design because they tend to fall off. So they're in your boxes for the awards. So please be sure to pick up your boxes before you leave because your scales are in there. We want to make sure the scales of justice are perfect. As you heard Kathy also say that they work on a very limited budget, if there's even a budget at all, right, to work with. So there is a golf outing in August. We hope that we can see all of you there and count on your support as well. That is August 24th here in Dublin, Ohio at the Golf Club of Dublin. It's a wonderful event that just, again, brings together everybody for one mission and one cause, and that is to protect crime victims' rights, make sure that they are heard and that they have a voice. And with that, I'm going to just say thank you. As a Crime Tracker 10 reporter for WBNS here at 10TV, we often, too many times, see and hear stories where the victims are, you know, either not being heard or their cases are falling through the cracks. I think Kathy and I have worked on a few stories over the years, and it's because of passionate people like Kathy and like all of you that we can actually effect some change here in Ohio. So thank you to all. Jeff?
And working with Angela in that regard with her crime tracking duties, I can tell you she's a passionate advocate for what we do as well to get the story right and get it on the air and all that. So thank you all for coming here tonight. We'll see you again next year. Enjoy the evening.
I think tonight was wonderful. I think it's really great when you can have victims of crime, both victims of crime and people that serve them, get the recognition that they so deserve, because way too often that does not happen. So to see a lot of these people validated and to see good work validated, it's a very positive thing. This is my second year I've come to this event, and I leave feeling very inspired, and I'm always in awe of the people that are given awards here. So I feel very fortunate I could participate in this event.
How you feel about it?
I just want to say that this has probably been one of the most memorable experiences. Being chosen for this award is just absolutely an honor. I love what I do every day. I love representing victims that unfortunately are labeled as defendants, but I'm glad that I can be there for them and help them through the legal system and give them the support and guidance and the respect that they deserve. So this has just been an absolute honor for me.
Thank you very much.
Oh, this award means a lot to me and everybody that works with me in Cuyahoga County and in the greater Cleveland area. The Justice League of Ohio is something that we desperately need for all victims in, obviously, Franklin County, but more so in Cuyahoga County, because right now we don't have anything like that. And I was just informed that that they're coming to Cuyahoga County, and I just think it'll be a wonderful addition to all the NGOs that we have up there to help the victims of domestic violence, human trafficking, and sexual assault.
Well, the Justice League is such a powerful force here in not only just Columbus and Franklin County, but all over the state of Ohio. The things that they do for victims' rights is outstanding. And we here in Columbus appreciate what you guys do and keep up the good work.
Thank you, Darla.
I didn't even know the Justice League existed. When I was being victimized, when I was being attacked, I didn't know there were some people behind the scenes helping people all over the place. When I came last year, it was so amazing to me to see. The world was a dark place at one point in time, and I didn't trust and I couldn't let people in. And so to come here and actually receive an award is awesome. I mean, awesome, like, that the system is being seen. And, like, what I do, like, helping other people helps me more than anything, you know? And I have no idea. Like, it's amazing. It's just amazing.
Thank you very much.
So the Justice League to me is just an amazing group of people that come together and stand up for the rights of others when they're not able to. They're just an amazing group of people. I've known Kathy for quite some time now, and I recall sitting with her and just talking about all my dreams and goals of the future and just talking and working through things over time and to see how things have progressed over time. And you know, I'm working with Kathy on a few things, and it's just an honor. It really, really is to know that they're making such a difference in people's lives. It's justice. It's exactly what it is. It's justice.
What tonight meant is just a reaffirmation for me when you listen to the honorees, what they represent, the courage, the fortitude, the persistence. You know, as a board member, you kind of ask yourself sometimes why you're doing what you're doing. Kathy is what brought me to the floor. And each time I hear the stories, it just more and more affirms for me that the mission that this organization has is just one that is worthy, and, you know, being a part of it is exciting. So I'm hoping that all that see this in the future, you know, if there is a chance for you to become a part of it in some way, whether it's a checkbook or getting on our board or volunteering for some of the things that we do, even if you don't want to be a board member, if you come to one of these dinners, you'll want to do that. And so it was just fantastic meeting the honorees and being here.